All right. Hello, everybody. This is James Stanley. Hope you're having a fantastic day today. It's pre-FOMC price action setups. So we have a lot to talk about. Not only do we have FOMC tomorrow, we have ECB the day after, and then core PCE on Friday. So the rest of this week is going to be pretty loaded. And I think from a perspective of a new trader, that seems like a lot of opportunity. But for an experienced trader, there's a lot of risk. So I'm going to parcel through a number of setups today. But first, I need to go through the risk disclaimer. I'm going to ask you to read this. I'm going to leave it on the screen for 60 seconds. I'll be on the other side, and then we'll start looking at some charts. But first, the disclaimer, please do read. See you in 60. All right, there we go. That's 60 seconds by my watch. And to everybody in the room saying good afternoon or hello, good afternoon, Jose, Eric, Carl, Steve, Paul. Awesome. Good to see you guys in. So like I said, there is some pretty considerable risk for the remaining portion of this week. I wanted to parcel today's webinar up a little bit differently than usual. Always looking to optimize, always looking to tweak. Which, by the way, if you have any ideas or recommendations, feel free to drop that in the YouTube comments on the archive of this video. But there's a lot going on. So first, let's just take a look at the economic calendar. And I want to draw your attention to this. I'm going to be speaking about this in a few moments. But we started off with some pretty rocky PMI prints out of Europe. There's Germany. This is just composite PMI coming in below expectations. But that 50 mark is pretty key. 50 is the delineator between expansion and contraction. Was expected at 50.3, came in at 48.3. So in contraction territory there in Germany, not great. But if we look at Europe as a whole, kind of the same deal. Composite PMI out of Europe, 48.9 off of 49.7 expectation. Again, somewhat disappointing. Hello, Ruth. Good to see you in the room. The real problem seems to be, so this is services PMI, a little bit inside expectations, but still in that expansionary territory. It's right in here, manufacturing, 42.7 on a 43.5% expectation, or a 43.5 expectation. And the German manufacturing PMI was also really, really dismal. But again, I'll get to that in a moment. This came out earlier this morning, and we'll be talking about this one too today. But here's where we start looking off into the future. There's tomorrow, the FOMC rate decision, 2 p.m., 2:30 for the press conference. The next morning, we get the ECB, though. That makes for a pretty interesting dynamic. We also get a GDP print in here, but we'll move by that for now. A BOJ rate decision later on in the evening. And then on Friday morning, more headline risk out of the U.S. with core PCE. Now, this is the Fed's preferred inflation gauge. Notice it was 4.6 last month. The expectation for this month is at 4.2. So still some pretty optimistic expectations out there for a continued drawdown in inflation. But that 4.2% is still well elevated above the Fed's 2% mark. All dynamics that we're going to be discussing today. Now, for that rate decision tomorrow, at this point, the expectation for markets, let me just refresh this, and I'm pulling this from CME Fedwatch, so it's essentially derived off futures markets, and it's target rate probabilities for each of the next few Fed meetings. So for tomorrow, we're currently at 500 to 525. The expectation is for a move up to 525 to 550, so a 25 basis point hike with a 98.9% probability. There's a slim probability, 1.1% for a 50 bip hike. So it's possible, but it just seems unlikely with what we have now. Going out to September, pretty much the same. There's a slight higher expectation, 20.8% probability for 50 basis points of hikes between now and September. November's where it starts to get a bit more interesting. We collate these up, and that collectively is a 41.4% probability of another hike there between now and November. But this is where things start to get really interesting. There we go. Right to December, there's actually building probabilities for a cut if we hike tomorrow. And then it's a lot slimmer for another continued hike. So that's where the rubber meets the road. It, at this point, given what we've seen between these four outlays, the market is expecting tomorrow to be the Fed's last rate hike of this cycle. There's a possibility of another 25 basis point hike, but markets seem much less sure of that. But for tomorrow, as far as what the Fed's going to do at that rate decision, this seems pretty locked in, given that it's at a 98.9% probability. If the Fed didn't hike 25 tomorrow, that could lead to pandemonium. So my expectation is that's what we're going to get. But with that said, this also means that the rate hike tomorrow is probably pretty well baked into the cake. The bigger item of concern is what the Fed says about their next meetings. As in, are they planning a second rate hike after tomorrow by the end of this year? Now, the types of trigger words I'll be looking for is if they say data dependent. I'm going to look at that as being somewhat dovish in that they don't want to commit to another rate hike, but they're keeping the door open to such, largely on the basis of how data forms, given that we have a core PCE print coming out a little later on this week. That's what I'm looking for out of the Fed tomorrow. I think the bigger question, and this is something that's been getting more airwave of late, is the ECB. And it's something that I've been talking about, something I wanted to point out right up here up front, and that there has been, say, some concern around the European economy in response to the rate hikes that the ECB has already posed. If we look at euro dollar, we could see that massive breakout that happened 2 weeks ago on the back of the CPI print in the US. There we go. Charts are really slow right now for some reason. There we go. And let's just pull this off a 4 hour, that'll work. So it was Wednesday, July 12th, when we had that US CPI hit. It was 3% in the US for headline inflation, core CPI still remaining elevated. But when we had that CPI print, it was almost like an immediate push in USD when the dollar ended up breaking through that support. In a related move, euro dollar popped through that resistance that it held through the first half of the year. That resistance zone that I was tracking between like 110 to 111. Let me go ahead and remove this wedge real fast. It's neither here nor there for today's conversation. There we go. But we had that strong topside break in euro dollar. When we looked at this last week, last Tuesday, as I had shared, we had just started to test a resistance level around 112.46. It ultimately ended up marking the high for that day right off of that Fibonacci level. That's the 618. Of the 2021 to 2022 major move. Real simply, you could find that from this high down to that low, the 618 of which is right there at 112.75. That got the high last week. And since then, there has not been a green day in euro dollar since. Prices just continued to pull back. Now, we talked about this last week, and what we said then was chasing a breakout while at a high, usually not a great idea, especially when it broke a resistance zone that was this pertinent, that it held two massive inflections, elicited two strong reversals earlier in the year. We finally got above that zone. So chasing it up here, that doesn't seem very advisable. The bigger test for the trend is what do bulls do when we pull back and test support and prior resistance, which we're doing right now. Now, initially last week, that 111.86 level that I was looking at came in to help hold the low like the morning after the webinar, led into a bounce. That bounce held a lower high. And since then, price has just been sliding lower All right, we're going to do a little bit of Googling here because I could tell you what my opinion is. I could tell you what I'm looking at, but I think it's much easier to just do a test together. So simply, I'm just going to type in European Central Bank. Financial Times from 4 hours ago, ECB under pressure to signal end of interest rate rises after fall in loan. We don't need to click on the article. CNBC, a momentous week ahead, neither here nor there. Reuters, will ECB slow its interest rate hikes as Eurozone inflation cools? So, I mean, just from these headlines, we could see that there's a growing chorus here for the ECB to take a step back. And like I showed a little earlier, those PMI prints that we had on Monday, they were very bad. But it was this fall in bank lending in the survey this morning that's starting to catch the alarm of many that are following this theme. So there's building expectations that the ECB may actually be closer to pivoting or pausing with a legitimate pause in rate hikes than what we've been seeing out of the Fed. Go to the Federal Reserve and do the same kind of test. And I'm just looking at the main headlines here, just as a quick and easy way to read sentiment. But same kind of deal. Fed meeting could signal end of rate hikes as housing, GDP, and inflation data. Interest rates expected to be raised after July, after Fed pause in June. You know, a different tone here, right? It doesn't seem, at least to my ears, as dovish as what we just looked at a moment ago with the ECB, where there's building hopes for the bank to put in their final hike tomorrow. What does this mean? Well, that trend that we saw in Eurodollar that we talked about last week that had just broken out to that fresh high. I mean, this thing is very much on trial over the next 2 days as we get the Fed tomorrow and then the ECB on Thursday. Now, the ECB, in my opinion, has a little bit more latitude. And the reason for that is because they're not issuing forward guidance any longer. We have to go off of their innuendo or the hints they drop within that press conference or that Lagarde drops during that press conference. And of late, something I've talked about quite a bit, the ECB has been very, very open about their hawkishness. And the reasons why makes sense. Because when the currency got absolutely demolished last year, a weaker euro brings on a potential for inflation. If you're an import-based economy and your currency is worth 20% less than it was a year ago, what producers are going to keep their prices the same? That 20% hit in the currency, that's pressing on your margins. And if your margins are less than 20%, well, that could be the difference between a profitable product or a loss on every product. And so we'll often see companies respond by raising prices in that area with the weaker currency to try to offset that lower currency exchange value. That can then lead to more and more inflation. And so we've seen the ECB with a very, very hawkish stance of late. But now we're at the point where we're starting to see it impact their data more heavily. And it seems as though that impact might be even a little heavier than what we've seen in the US. So a lot of question marks for the next couple of days. In Eurodollar, what I'm looking at here is we're in that long-term zone between 110 and 111. 110, I think, is a massive spot there. Notice how it caught this high back in June. Major psychological level. I mean, it was hoping to hold the highs back here in February. Price almost begrudgingly tested beyond this zone in April and then May, but it couldn't really do much beyond it. When we finally did break out, we snapped back, but that's where I'm anticipating a big support test taking place at. There's another level of reference, though. So that 112.75 level, that's the 618 of the 2021-2022 major move. 109.43 is the 50% mark of that same study. It's also had some recent relevance as both support and resistance. This could set the stage where if we do end up with a strong USD on the back of the Fed tomorrow, and what I would anticipate there is if the Fed issues the dot plot matrix signals another hike for 2023, showing my age, I can't remember the year, but if they show another hike expected for 2023, which is currently not showing per CME Fedwatch, so it doesn't appear that something like that is baked in the cake, that could give USD bulls more motivation to push that trend a little bit higher, which could allow for a break below 110, moving towards that 109.43 area. I also have a trend line that's confluent with that price around tomorrow. Trend line really easy to find. Take it from the late May low, connect that to the early July swing low. projection of which, it's right around that 109.43 price for tomorrow. If we get down there after the Fed, my expectation is that this thing is going to be fairly stretched, because you can see we're already working on a sixth consecutive loss, six consecutive down days. And that's somewhat of an abnormality. This is just charting consecutive days, green or red. To get six consecutive down days in euro dollar, that was the last time that happened, was basically when it had bottomed back here in September, right? So if it gets a seventh down day tomorrow around the Fed, then that would be an outlier given this historical sample. So long term, this is an opportunity for bulls to support the trend, as we're testing support at prior resistance. Prices pulled back fairly aggressively. The trend is still there. Shorter term, that's where things get a little dicier, because there has been ample opportunity for bulls to load the boat after getting within this 111 zone, but they still haven't shown a willingness to step in here to hold the lows. So that 110 area is what I'm tracking as the next spot. If 110 shows a bounce, then I'm looking for a resistance test right here on 110.60. The next major area of support, I'm looking at that 109.43, but there's even a spot here, 109.71, that could be of interest if we just tick below that 110 zone. But short-term bearish, long-term, that bullish trend is still there. But it's exactly like I said last week. If this trend is going to remain bullish, we're nearing the spot where buyers need to respond. If we breach 109.43, we breach that trend line, this is going to look like a massive reversal here on the monthly chart. That's very messy. Let me go to something cleaner right there. Where that monthly bar, it's going to be mostly upper wick, right? So test of the breakout, hardcore rejection if we can't hold, say, above like that 110 level going into the end of the month. That's what I'm looking at on euro dollar. I'm going to do things a little differently today, so we start with that one. USD, so mirror image in my book. And again, kind of the same thing that we talked about last week, where there was that really prolonged bearish trend that had very much dominated in USD. Let's start with this one. Had very much dominated with USD ever since this thing topped in Q4 last year. Well, technically topped into Q3, but I digress. For the first half of this year, we had price building in this consolidation pattern. It's a descending triangle. So lower highs to go along with horizontal support. The CPI report from a couple of weeks ago is what helped to allow for that breach. Get under the daily chart, and we could see that really bad Wednesday when that CPI report came out. I say really bad. It's neither bad nor good. It's just a move. But we could see that really big bar that printed on Wednesday after that CPI report came out. And again, in my opinion, this was markets trying to prime for the Fed to actually pause. Not after tomorrow, but Or not for tomorrow, but after tomorrow. So as we had that print, and as the ECB had remained vociferously hawkish, there was excuse to tilt flow into euro dollar away from USD. There was even some follow through on Thursday. But what we looked at last week was a really short-term double bottom formation that had formed in here. You see it? Right down there. A double bottom, that low that was hit on Friday, that low that was hit on Tuesday. Go down a little shorter term. The neckline for that formation was right here, 100 spot 18. So if you do some real simple math to plot a double bottom reversal setup, a real easy way to do it, just get it where the 50 fib is lined up. That projects to approximately 100 spot 75. For that double bottom to clear. That already happened. That happened a couple of days after we talked about it. And, that lined up fairly well with the key zone of prior support, like 100 spot 80 up to 101. And it even offered a quick dash of resistance on Thursday, but the pullback there was a higher low, got bid, and then another push up to another fresh higher high on a short-term basis. At this point off the daily, we could see where that short-term bullish trend is digging deeper and deeper into the prior bearish move. But it's just like I said last week, this is where bears have that open opportunity to come in and push the trend if they legitimately believe it has continuation potential behind it. So for right now, USD is working on its sixth consecutive up day, which is somewhat unusual. We haven't had six consecutive up days in DXY since back here. That's May of 2022, when the trend was still in full bloom. But notice what that instance led to. Now, it's just one instance. But that was the final day. We hit resistance at 105 after, and then we pulled back. The prior instance, right there on 106. It was pretty hot to trot. That's when we hit that resistance on 103.82. Pulled back, reloaded, and then it went back for another trip. Right? So six consecutive up days in DXY is something that has not happened since the dollar topped on September 28th. We have those, well, we have five, and it's working on a sixth right now, but you'll notice that sixth is kind of fledgling, right? It's currently showing as a doji on the daily, but that's also at a pretty major spot on the chart. Draw Fibonacci retracement around this recent major move, and that's the 50% mark. It's a pretty big spot in the Fibonacci study that helps to keep the prevailing trend alive as long as we're holding that resistance. It's also a prior swing from back here. Helped to hold the lows in like mid-January into the end of that month. There's another spot a little bit higher though, and this kind of goes to that thesis if we do end up with a quick, you know, sugar rush USD theme around the Fed tomorrow, around 102, right? 102 is a price we've talked about quite a bit. It's the 50% mark of the 2021-2022 major move. Also the 618 of this recent bearish sell-off. Right, so if we do see bulls power through this to complete that sixth consecutive daily gain, then that's the next level to look for resistance to come in at. And then the concern would be, you know, possible overbought conditions on a short-term basis, because that trend came back really very quickly. So there's an open door here for bears. And I think the interesting scenario there is if we do see the Fed maybe err on the side of dovishness or being passive tomorrow, which again, I'd anticipate with, you know, some type of pledges towards data dependency, that could lead to pullback, right? And then this real solid area here, what has been a solid area here from around 100 spot 80 up to 101, that then becomes a support test in this short-term bullish move. If bulls could hold that going into ECB, there could be the potential for a short-term bullish trend to continue in there. If we see USD strength after the Fed, then that's the next level I'm looking for resistance to move to, 102. And if it's holding there, I'm still going to be pretty cautious about bearish trend potential on the longer term, like daily and above. That's what I'm looking at USD. Strong pullback off those breakouts, but the door has not closed for trend continuation purposes, especially given that we're holding the 50 of that recent breakdown move. Dollar yen. So this one, also going to be hit by a couple of different rate decisions this week. We have the Fed tomorrow, ECB Thursday, then BOJ on Thursday night. Last I had read, there was little expectation for any changes out of the BOJ. And, you know, while inflation does remain, you know, relatively brisk there, there is still no sign that I've seen that the BOJ is ready to do any kind of formal changes to policy. You know, I mean, I think if you're the Bank of Japan, you're kind of getting what you want with currency weakness still holding around. And so it would seem as though there's, you know, maybe even less motivation to push any changes right here. Taking a step back, when we had that rush of USD weakness on the back of CPI, on the back of falling expectation for future rate hikes, dollar yen absolutely fell out of bed. And there's a really good lesson in here as to how trends turn. And it's kind of similar to what we looked at in Eurodollar a moment ago, just this one on a longer term basis. So we first tagged that 145 level late June. It's a major level. That was the level that stalled the move last year for about a month. And initially, bulls were still coming to the table. Like, we tested the support, bulls held the bid, but they couldn't get back above that 145 level and led into a slow build of lower highs. And then eventually we get the lower low. And then we get to bounce up to a lower high. And then this thing absolutely unravels. And in my book, this started with a pullback in some of these yen themes, but it got a whole new life around that CPI print in the US right there. And you can see what's happening there. We're breaking below 140. There's the CPI print Wednesday, driving all the way until we found support at a really big spot on the chart, 137.68. Not an unfamiliar price. Swing low back here in November, helped to hold these highs in December. Beautiful inflection here in March, and then again, early May. That one in particular is important because this happened just after a BOJ rate decision. And that was where Kazuo Ueda, his first meeting atop the bank, you know, he successfully assuaged fears that he was going to jolt markets with some inevitable change. And I think markets are still kind of getting to know Kazuo Ueda. But after having a couple of rate decisions atop the BOJ now, I mean, in my book, it's pretty clear that he doesn't want to start a forest fire here by scaring markets about what might possibly happen. He seems to be erring on the side of stability where at all possible. That support inevitably helped to hold, a strong breakdown push. But notice this doji here to help complete help set up a Morningstar formation right in there. And ever since that Morningstar printed, bulls have been in order. We had a second test of that support last Tuesday morning, just before we had talked on this webinar. That led to a move back up to 140. Pullback, hold of higher low at prior resistance. Continuation move into Friday, and it's just been pulling back so far this week. On a short-term basis, we could see where support is holding at a prior area of resistance like 140.95. I don't feel good about that level, and the reason is because we've had a couple of pokes already, and each of those have brought, or we're starting to see a diminishing marginal impact of that support, as shown by that, the lower highs that have happened since that support's been in play. So you can see where it kind of takes on the tonality of a descending triangle. But, you know, maybe even more to the point, we have this really big zone here at 140 to 140.30. And 140.30 is a price I like quite a bit because of this Fibonacci retracement. Again, same 2021, 2022 major move. It's shown some real interesting inflections already this year, like the 50 fib of that move is what caught the low back in January. The 38.2 of that move had some pretty considerable interchange here, support, resistance, support again, before it launched. 140.30s even had some pull, shown as resistance. It tried to show a support here, but, you know, again, that was just before that CPI report out of the U.S. But there hasn't been much for support since this has broken back above that level. And so if we could see that 140.95 level given way, that is the area where I'd be looking for bulls to be tested. And if they want to continue the trend, that's the area that I would look for them to defend. And I think dollar yen is still one of the more interesting setups for bullish USD scenarios, you know, largely on the back of that expectation that, you know, the BOJ doesn't want to rock the boat until they absolutely have to, and it doesn't appear as though they absolutely have to right now. So this is what I would keep on the radar as one of the possibly more attractive venues for bullish USD scenarios at the moment. That's what I'm looking at, dollar yen. All right, I'm going to run through the next few. So I looked at dollar yen as one of the more attractive setups on the long side or for bullish USD scenarios. Cable. I'm looking at this as one of the more attractive setups for the short side of the dollar. If we do end up seeing dollar bears come back, punch the currency lower off 101.50 or maybe even like 102, the top side of cable is pretty interesting. A couple of different things going on here. A second, I want to make sure I got the right one. There we go. We'll go off this one first. So one of the reasons that I'm reading this or taking that scenario is when USD weakness was in full bloom after that CPI report a couple of weeks ago, cable was running higher with a fairly aggressive breakout. This was one of the stronger majors on my radar. It inevitably got caught here around 130.150, and that's what helped to hold the high. That's not the one I'm looking for. But after that high came in, prices began to pull back, and then, you know, kind of similar to that USD scenario where it started as a pullback and then, you know, it built speed as there was more evidence of something else shifting. UK CPI report came out softer than expected. Headline at 7.9%. headline CPI at 7.9%, core CPI at 6.9%, both disappointing figures. Both also well above what we're seeing in the US or Europe at the moment. So if there's a central bank that's forced to address still well elevated inflation, the BOE is in that conversation. So when we look at this, there was again like seven consecutive days of pullback after that fresh high was printed. There is a trend line down here that hasn't yet come into play, but this is of interest for support. There's also this level, 128.50, prior spot of resistance. You can see where bulls tried to hold it as support, but bears haven't exactly had a free run since getting below. And so far today, pretty strong response to that support. So I'm still considering this as one of the more attractive setups on the short side of the dollar, largely on the basis of that divergence between inflation scenarios at the BOE and the Fed. You know, the big question is always around the Fed, are they going to hit equity markets? I don't think they want to. I think the Fed ideally wants to be not the reason that markets sell off. You know, and if we go back and look at the history of the Fed, or, you know, especially over the last couple of years with, you know, this rate hike scenario that they're dealing with, or the inflation scenario they're dealing with, you know, they really kind of painted themselves in the corner with transitory. And I think last year was trying to get out of that corner. And I think at this point they feel like they have, and that they hiked so fast, so aggressively, that, you know, they've made strides. I don't think any of these central banks want to come out and create pandemonium if they don't have to. And so if we do end up with a softer Fed tomorrow, I think this is one of the areas that could be more interesting to look for that situation to work through. Eric wanted to look at dollar CAD for sure. So, you know, my take on dollar CAD is usually it's got a proclivity as to be maybe a little less volatile on a general basis, just because of that cross-border trade that takes place between the US and Canada. It's going to take a minute for these drawings to populate. And there we go. Just hide those real fast. There we go. Okay, so like I said, in my book, it's pretty much got a proclivity to be a ranger. And, you know, sure enough, last 8 years, it's kind of what it's been doing. Sorry, Eric, I know I probably said that to you before. There was an even tighter range that built in here, and we broke below that range a couple of weeks ago, helped along with another push on CPI. But, you know, off this weekly chart, what's real interesting is look at all these underside wicks, right? Look at all of that. And I mean, it's been going on for a month already, you know? So you can't exactly say that bears haven't had their chance, because they have. They just haven't been able to do anything with it. And then, you know, there's an assist coming from this trend line, and it's kind of a tricky trend line because there's so much going on here. But what I'll do in these cases is I'll actually fit it around, or try to. You know, as I was taught with trend lines, a good trend line is like setting a carburetor, where you just kind of got to feel around for it to see what the best spot might be. And so I'll anchor it right here with this magnet, and then I can like legitimately test it out. So like I'll try that swing to see where it held, and oh well, we have another pretty beautiful touch there, beautiful touch there, beautiful touch there, beautiful touch there. That one seems like it's kind of the happy medium, right? Go down here. Oh, there's only two touches. That's not a trend line. That's a coincidence. Go right there. It aligns. That one aligns even better. So you kind of got to feel with those trend lines to get them in the right spot. But, you know, so in my book, that was a trend line inflection that helped to hold the low. Go down a little shorter term, and now I can bring that wedge back. There we go. And so there's been the build of a falling wedge as bears have basically been stifled since like late June. You know, there's been multiple tests to break through here. There's a couple of things below. There's the 130 level. There's, of course, that trend line. There's a few different things going on. But, you know, as this has been happening, it's built in a falling wedge, and that's a bullish reversal pattern. So, you know, I'm keeping this one on the side of the ledger for long USD setups. Near term, 32.24 is of issue. It's a big price. And this is far from perfect, but it looks like there's a short-term ascending triangle trying to build in here with horizontal resistance right there at that 3224 spot. And then a series of higher lows that have been coming into play since 3224 has been holding the highs, right? Ascending triangles are beautiful because of the deduction. You know, you got a diminishing marginal impact from resistance as shown by now multiple higher lows. We had another test in here, even if it doesn't break, that's okay. It's as long as it holds the pace of that sequencing of where each of these resistance inflections are bringing diminishing marginal impact, thereby leading to the possibility of resistance break. And then we got the test of the longer term trend line. I wouldn't get too caught in on this trend line. It's just, again, 2 points of touch. Whole point of showing that or looking at that is to highlight the mood of the market. And that's the fact that bears have not been stretching at lows while they have been stretching at highs. But that's what I'm looking at, dollar cat. Big support underneath 130, the trend line. There's this Fibonacci level as well. And this fib retracement has produced quite a few inflections. It's just 2020 to 2021 major move. But the 618 is what I was using back here at 3652. 3338 was support, resistance a couple weeks back. But interesting setup. I got this one still in a range though, or with range-like tendencies at least. All right, Aussie. I'm still pretty unclear on Aussie. I will not pretend otherwise. I still don't have a great feel on this one. And I think one of the things that's become burdensome for me is just there's not a lot of range that has been building in between highs and lows. And when I say that, what I mean is like if we look at this move here, you know, so I mean this is basically just going back a little over a month. You know, that top's just inside of the 69 handle. And this is the 66 handle. It's essentially been oscillating within a 300 pip range. Generally, I want things that are, you know, trending or showing some proclivity to trend and even take a step back. And the range was even tighter before that. So it's expanding, which could be leading to a break in one direction or the other. It's just very uncertain at this point. What I like better is the possibility of response to a break, as in if we do get a topside breach of that 69 level, there's the 70 psych level, just a little bit higher, and then there's the 71.36 Fibonacci level that's already shown a couple of different tendencies or a couple of different resistance inflections and a tendency to hold the high. 38.2 is what's helped to hold the recent low so far, and the 50% mark's right in the middle, 68.27, which becomes an issue if we do see this thing push back up towards that range resistance. But I still have this in a relatively tight range, not super enticing for me at the moment. All right, that's what I have on the majors. Gonna look at a couple of yen pairs now. So like I was saying on dollar yen, I don't think that the BOJ is in a spot where they wanna kick off a forest fire if they do not have to. Euro yen then thereby becomes interesting as a possibly a referendum on what's happening around the ECB, market-based referendum that is. And that, you know, if we look at euro dollar, kind of like I was showing a moment ago, we have the concern, well, what's the Fed going to say? What's the ECB going to say? There's possibility of change in both. If there's less possibility of change in Japan, this then becomes more of just a straight euro story in my book. And 158 has become the fly in the ointment of bulls. It's held multiple highs now, late June, again in early July, and then again last Friday. Let me go a little bit tighter here. There we go. I think this one plays a little cleaner. Life is a technical analyst. I got charts for everything. There's that resistance inflection. Led to a pullback. Yesterday, this thing was trying to hold at this trend line support. It even gave a small bounce. But that same resistance came back into play. Another push lower, and now we're testing another support level. So, you know, again, I'm kind of taking this as a referendum on the ECB at the moment, since there's little expectation for the Bank of Japan to change. And to mirror that theme, this would be very similar to what I was looking for in early July on USD dollar yen, where it started with a bit of a pullback in the yen, you know, again, similarly shared here in euro yen. But what really took on a life of its own was Wednesday, July 12th, after that CPI print, when the dollar absolutely fell out of bed. Dollar yen broke 140, continued to head lower, eventually got that 137.68 support print. You know, but here in euro yen, it bottomed before that CPI print was out, right? Wednesday, July 12th, that's where the low came in. So that's where those two themes started to diverge. The euro yen, it went right back up to the highs, just couldn't break. So if we do see the ECB coming out passive, dovish, then my expectation would be for this one to continue to drop. The next level I'd be tracking, a longer term level, is right down here, 153.46. Reason that I'm tracking that one so closely, possible neckline for a double top. It's messy, but I would consider this as one instance, and then another instance of resistance. Neckline of which sets right there, 153.46. That's about 450 pips of distance between top to neck, which if it fills, projects to a possible move down towards around 149. That could be interesting for volatility. But again, I think the situation that would need to fall is the ECB would need to directly be dovish, as in, you know, no hinting, no innuendo, some kind of claim that, you know, inflation's coming down. We're also concerned about data like we saw in the bank lending survey, like we saw in the PMI prints. You know, we're going to take this meeting by meeting. If they say that, I would probably take that as being somewhat dovish, meeting by meeting, data dependency. You know, I would take those as signs of dovishness. If Lagarde overtly says we're looking at more hikes, then I'd construe that as hawkish. Then I'd expect that at some point, that 158 level to be in play. Whether or not it gives way, I don't know. It's already held two pretty strong advances, so that's the test. Pound yen, however, you know, like I shared a little earlier, it doesn't appear as though the Bank of England has as much flexibility as the ECB might, given that recent, I mean, that continued hold of very aggressively high inflation. In pound yen, though, give me a second, we got to go longer term. Actually, I think I already have one of these dolled up. There we go. That's the one. Already dolled up. All pretty and ready for show. So the high here is coming in at a very key spot. It's the 50 mark of a long-term major move, taking the high from 07, drawing that down to the low in 2011. 50% of that is 183.95. That came into play a couple of weeks ago. I noticed that bulls just continue to spin their wheels. Until eventually bears started to pull. Now, when they did start to pull it, and you could see off this weekly chart, I think this is the best place to look. When they did start to pull it back, that 180 level has been continuing to kick in as support. Notice we had the doji here, another test in the following week. This one ends up stronger than the last. So normally if I see something like this, two tests of the same support with a slightly higher low, this one's a bullish bar after a bearish. This is still looking pretty indecisive, right? But this is a hammer and that's a doji. This is a hammer because you have a slightly more full body setting at the top of the candle, all of that underside wick showing a bullish response to that support test. So normally with something like that, I'm going to look for price to fling back into resistance for another test into that zone. And then we get a little tighter and there's a couple areas to look for, like 183.18. Right in there, support turn resistance before that thing really started to spill lower. If it gets through 183.18, then 183.95 comes back into the picture, but that could be a difficult price to mount. The reason that I'm so attached to this one is that longer term setup where, you know, this is still historically a very elevated level, very elevated price. And if we are going to see a pullback in that yen theme, this is probably going to be one of the areas that I'm going to want to track that with. Euro yen could be enticing. This is completely at odds with the fundamental scenario as I've laid out, right? Because if we look at the BOE, they probably have less latitude, given that inflation remains stickier there. You know, so I mean, if we're just reading the fundamental tea leaves right now, and I had to guess whether the ECB or the BOE was going to be the first to cut, I'd probably guess the ECB. But from a technical perspective, the move that I like better is here, largely because of that test of a long-term Fibonacci level. The fact that the ride has started to really shake after that resistance came into play. I don't know that it's topped yet. Like I was shown off the weekly, it seems as though there would be an open door for bulls to test that level. But if they don't, even that's notable. And these yen pairs, they could really move. They could be very volatile. So at some point, there could be a big scenario to work with here. But, you know, I don't think the BOJ is going to force that unless they absolutely have to. I don't think they have to here. All right, that's what I have on the currency front. I want to start looking at a couple of commodities and then I'm going to start taking some questions. Gold. So the question I have on gold is whether or not that 2K level is going to, whether it's already taken its toll. Let's get this one populated and I'll show you what I'm looking at. Chart's really slow right now and I don't know why. There we go. All right. So the question I have is whether or not 2K has already taken its toll. And here's where I'm drawing that from. We had the 1900 support test right here in late June. And notice there was a tonality shift after that, right? It started slow. Initially, there was these tests of resistance of prior support, but, you know, bears weren't giving way easily. You know, kind of like we've been talking about, diminishing marginal impact of resistance. And notice slightly higher lows as that resistance is continually tested. Eventually, it leads to breakout. Then up to the next level, 1968, resistance holds, pullback, 1950. Into breakout. The question I asked a moment ago, and where I'm deriving that from, is the fact that that breakout last Tuesday was really strong, right? But it got caught at that 1981 level. Wednesday, bulls were still pushing. Thursday, they pushed again and got as high as 1989 spot eight. So the reason I'm asking that question is because if you look at gold when it's at 1989 spot eight, even take the exact top, say 1988, and we're $12 off that 2K level, you go for it? Or do you take a step back? Think of it from your own perspective. There's not a right answer here. Sometimes it'll go for it, sometimes it won't. In my book, the determinant as to whether or not price goes for it is just how bullish sentiment is at the time. And if it doesn't go for it, then it tells you that it doesn't see a good risk reward set up there. If that resistance is $12 away and they won't even go for a retest, there's probably a reason why. Now, with that said, when you get this bullish run, what is it that pushes prices? It's more buyers than sellers. It's more longs getting long. And shorts getting less short. So when we get up here, foreseeably, you have a market that has just been getting long, as driven or dictated by the price movement. But once you have this oscillation near resistance, you know, that's longs grinding out, that's shorts opening up. The pullback so far is held above the key level of 1950. 1950 is that line in the sand that I would want to see bulls defend to keep the door open for bullish scenarios in gold. And it's done that so far. So that possibility is still there. But you know, given that we have the Fed, and then I haven't even really gotten into PCE in this webinar, but we have PCE on Friday, expected at 4.2%. You know, bullish outcomes in USD could be very, very challenging for the long side of gold. I know it's like a Captain Obvious statement, but the fact that buyers were not even willing to go up for a 2K retest as they were back in early June is notable. It makes me wonder if I got a little too cute looking for a bounce off that 1900 level to run into 2K. Jury's still out. I'm going to have to wait. But what I'm looking at in gold as far as levels are concerned, same levels still apply in my book. 1969 is a little bit higher. 1981 is still of note. I mean, you can see where there was some significant grind taking place at that level. Bulls were not able to go above. If we mount above that, this becomes the next area of resistance. And then 2K. On the underside of price action, 1949, again, that's the level that I think that I want to see bulls defend to keep the door open for topside sets. Below that 1936, that's that same level of resistance taken from prior support that was coming into play as this was grinding near the lows. That becomes the next support. We take out 1936. I'm going to be looking at this as an uh-oh kind of move on the long side of it, at least. 1900 becomes the next spot to look for. That's what I'm looking at in gold. And this is an indicative market. This is gold futes. spot gold is available on Forex.com, not gold futures. I'm going to look at a couple other indicative markets here. Dow. All right, so the Dow had a textbook head and shoulders pattern. Textbook. Rarely seen that pretty. And I personally do not like head and shoulders patterns. They're too ornate. Prefer one, two, or maybe three bar sequences because I'm from Texas and I value simplicity because I can't always, I value simplicity just in general. But there's the inverse head and shoulders pattern. This broke out last Tuesday and it hasn't really stopped. There was one down day, that was on Friday, and it's barely down. Notice it doji'd, right? But what's really interesting about this is the shift. The Dow is currently at fresh yearly highs, breaking above a big resistance level, continuing to rush. Then you look at the Nasdaq, again, indicative. You look at Nasdaq futures, they're quite a bit more calm and reserved. Waiting for my drawings to come back. There we go. A lot more calm and reserved. You look at this on a weekly chart. Sorry, I know there's a lot going on there. There we go. You look at this on a weekly chart. Last week just printed as a shooting star. Shooting stars are real interesting formations. They're bearish reversal formations, largely because of what it is they're saying. And what that candle's saying is it initially started off the week with rally. Came up here and tested this 88.6 Fibo retracement. 88.6, not a common Fibo retracement, but it's one I keep on my charts. That level helped to mark the high last week, at which point sellers started to come back. Now, I had tweeted about a rising wedge formation, and that started to give way on Wednesday. There was a doji right after that resistance, right after that Fibonacci level came in, 16.051. And that led to a pretty strong pullback. You know, largely on Thursday, but it's a continuation on Friday. And then yesterday was a minor doji that held, but held above a really big spot. That really big spot is right here. Prior spot of resistance. I'm not going to call it a double top because those two highs are off by a little more than I'd want. 15.475 for one and then around 15.430 for the other. But collectively, this makes up a zone. A support zone. Price didn't even get all the way down there yesterday, but along the way it started to build a falling wedge formation, which is breaking out today. So that's bullish. Buyers are pushing. The notable item, though, in my mind, is the fact that the Dow is pushing to fresh yearly highs, and the Nasdaq still is in this pullback type of mode. Now that might be neither here nor there. But if we're in an expansionary environment, generally speaking, the high beta equities, like what's commonly in the NASDAQ 100, will usually lead the way higher. Now, the fact that we're pulling back, I think there's a couple of different things going on. One, we're in earnings. Two, I mean, this was just a massive run. I think the first half of this year was even historic for the NASDAQ and the degree of strength that had shown. And, you know, sure enough, you look early 2023, I mean, it's been a strong topside run. There was some questions building in February going into March, but a banking crisis in the U.S. is what helped to bring bulls back into the fray, driven by the idea that the Fed might be at that pause or pivot point. I think the reason that explains this divergence is the trepidation about what's going on here and where markets are maybe fearful that the Fed talks up another hike later in the year at tomorrow's rate decision. I think that would not be as impactful to the Dow as it would be to the NASDAQ. That's my take, at least. But still of interest. And, you know, that the Dow is just continuing to fly or has been continuing to fly. NASDAQ breaking out of that short-term falling wedge so far today. That's what I have for today, guys. I'm almost out of time and I wanted to take a few of these questions and, been pontificating for a long time. So thank you for listening. From Cameron Ahmad, gold failed again to regain 2K with U.S. economic indicators, PMI, consumer confidence, et cetera, looking much better than Europe. Interest rates will remain elevated despite topping. Is gold bearishness expected to take hold? I think it could really quickly, you know, but I guess my fear there is even when it seemed as though bears had a wide open door to take this thing, they didn't, you know? And let me draw back to that weekly and monthly chart to tell that story, because there we go, monthly. This thing has been a hardcore range bound for 3 years now. You know, like we had the initial impetus here when COVID came to the equation. That drove us into this range, but we've just been oscillating back and forth, you know, three different trips to resistance, two different to support so far since COVID's been in the equation. And so when it started to break down here, and then, you know, the Fed is being very clear, they're not done with rate hikes yet. They still got to address inflation. I mean, it seemed as though bears had that open door to push this down. But, you know, I talked about this where there was like almost a proclivity for bear traps to develop so that, you know, if gold was sitting there around support for too long, be careful. And, you know, 1900, sure enough, helped to get the low. So we haven't seen, you know, that full-throated push from sellers yet. And that's what has me somewhat concerned, because they've seemingly had an open door to do so, even when breaking below a trend line, you know, testing another psychological level. They just haven't been able to take it yet. So, you know, I'm still keeping the 2K retest on my bingo card as a possibility for later on this year, but I'm looking to see what happens at that 1950 level to give me an idea for near-term trends here. But, you know, deduction could be a very important thing, because if bears don't take an opportunity, you gotta wonder why. You know, and they could have pushed this thing off into the oblivion over the past couple of months, and they just haven't yet. It's held up. Doesn't necessarily mean I want to get super long on it, but at the very least, I got a question on the short side. From Apollo, hello James, add BTC and Swissy to the list. All right, I don't got much on Swissy, but happy to share my Bitcoin chart with you. It's another one of those indicative markets, not available on Forex.com, but I've had this thing in a remarkably stable range. Almost used remarkably stable in Bitcoin as an oxymoron. And I don't mean that as a besmirchment against Bitcoin. It's just that this is not an asset that I would anticipate being quiet, range bound, and coiled up in the way that it has been. But there we go. That's probably the best chart for it. Yeah, so this range we've been in for a month now. And again, pretty tight. There was a couple tests of key support, a couple of key resistance. It finally broke that yesterday. The level that I'm looking for is down here, like 28,452, 28,600. I'm following that for next support. And, you know, what's really interesting to me about Bitcoin is this weekly chart, because, you know, look at that. Four consecutive weekly holds right at that resistance, 31013. But, you know, I think there's value in these longer term charts on Bitcoin. That's the next level that really sticks out to me. And that's where it comes from, 28,600, right back there. It was a swing low from June of 2021. And then it started to come back into play more frequently. There we go. That's the one. Right, it set this shelf of support like summer 2022. We break down, and then it's like a shelf of resistance here through March, April. Quick dash of resistance in May. Comes back in the equation, hasn't yet been retested for support after the topside break. That's interesting. Let's see what I do have on Swissy. Like I said, I'm not super active on this one. I got some personal drama with the Swiss National Bank. Well, it's kind of a weird thing to hear, but so as a rule, I don't do much in Swissy. So seeing this thing sub 87 is peculiar for me. 87, you know, and I think we'd even talked about this like last week, but you know, it was a low back here, you know, but since then there was no sub 87 prints in Swissy. Let's say for, you know, the incident that I was referring to a moment ago. Go down a little bit tighter, there we go. And, you know, again, this seems like very much a CPI fueled breakdown type of move. And then that Thursday, it's almost like, you know, dollar bulls are just ticked off and they didn't even want to support, you know, throw in any support there. And, you know, continuation move starts to set that support on Friday, builds in a falling wedge breaks out. And to me, it looks like this is trying to build in a sequence of higher highs and higher lows. You know, what I'd be tracking for support right now is at 86.32 level, and then resistance right at that same 87 spot. We break above 87, 87.58 becomes next resistance. And then I'm looking next support as a hold there at 87. 88.60 is next resistance after that. And there might be another level like a pull. I just haven't done it. And if we get resistance there, look for support there and, you know, continued case for reversal themes. Still in the early stages of that, though. All right, so this is all I have time for. I went over my time again, but Mr. Gordon Gecko with a really good one here. Hey, James, just a side question after you're done with charts on how the Fed now will affect currency markets. If it's fundamental, how can we prepare? I'm going to be real honest with you. I do not know. You know, it's as a payment transaction medium, you know, I want to say that it's a null effect, but I think that would be remiss and a lack of consideration of some of the other dynamics that have gone on in the market, namely the one that we just looked at with Bitcoin. You know, because, you know, as I understand it, FedNow is kind of an answer to the CBDC question, you know, central bank digital currencies, or, you know, trying to address the same ill, if you will, you know, for payment mediums. My concern would be what happens next, right? Because the acceptance that we've heard of cryptocurrencies on a governmental level has largely been as a payment medium, as a transaction medium. You know, that's one of the very positive things that we hear from all these, you know, political type of people when exalting the benefits of Bitcoin. It's that it levels the playing field. It makes it easier to transact or send money. And if they're going to instead do that with a different service, you know, like FedNow, then it would seem as though they're trying to remove one of those use cases that has been pushing the demand. That'd be my consideration of it. You know, with cryptocurrency as a whole, I'm still surprised that the, especially Western governments, didn't take a stronger stance against them. And I'm not saying that I want them to. I'm not taking a political side here. I'm a trader. My job's to observe and then react. You know, so whatever happens, happens. It's on me to be okay with that. But if you look historically for like the history of fiat currencies, the number one thing that you don't want to do is allow a competitor to your currency. Because once there's a competitor to your currency and then there's capital flows out of that currency, the currency weakens, inflation goes up, and you don't even have a handle on it anymore because there's an alternative currency out there that people can use. So if you want to bring demand back into that prior currency, well, good luck. You know, you really have to go out of your way to make that happen. And so I was really surprised that it went as long as it did without being addressed by Western politicians. But it is what it is. The question I have is whether or not Bitcoin is too big to fail at this point, which I really don't know the answer to it. You know, I know some people I know in banking would laugh at me for even asking that question. And then I know a lot of people that are heavy in the crypto universe that would laugh at them for laughing at me for even asking that question. So I don't know. But my initial take on it is that it's a shot across the bow against crypto, against Bitcoin, and maybe more to the point, a lot of these altcoins that have popped up. All right, so we're going to take one last one from Apollo. I can tell he put some thought into this one, so I don't want to just close it off. From Apollo, hello, James. The economic data has been coming rather weak, consequent of the consecutive rate hikes from central banks. By their nature, rates take time to affect the economy. Now, with the promise by all to keep interest rates high for long, means the data will continue coming weak before the latest hit to the economy. This means a recession may come and send prices of DJI dropping like rocks. Yeah, it's possible. It is possible. You know, so I got kind of a funny aside on this. It's something I've been talking about some of my buddies with, but it's always funny to me to notice how some of the smartest people I know in markets are inherently bearish. Like, just generally speaking, some of the smartest people I know were bearish. And this is over the last few years, not just right now. You know, during a face-ripping rally of historic proportion, you know, some of the smartest people I know have remained bearish throughout. And so my take in the conversation, my contribution was essentially that the same phrase of, if you're so smart, then why are you unhappy all the time? You know, because, and I think that kind of holds some truth there too, right? Where smart people might have a tendency to maybe overthink things, more anxious, you know, less accepting of reality. So I think there could be a tendency for intelligence to have a negative correlation with just general overall happiness levels. And I think the same holds true with markets. What makes it difficult is we can only project with what we know now. So like if I project tomorrow or Thursday or Friday, I can only do that off of the basis of what we have presenting today. Kind of like you said, the economic data has had a negative tilt to it of late, right? So we can't see, say, like the Thursday GDP report out of the US. It might be a banger, you know? And that automatically makes projections frail or fragile, as Nassim Taleb would say, because we can only base those projections for tomorrow off of the given facts of today. We can't implement a neural network that's responsive to, or reflexive, let's use that as a better term, that's reflexive to the other data that comes to the picture of the equation. But your opinion has most definitely been, you know, a popular opinion out there across markets of the Fed's backed themselves into a corner. Inflation is still way too high. They have to continue raising rates. You look at things like, you know, home buying affordability. There's a lot of porous marks across the economy right now. But I think probably the best way to address that question, at least from a trader perspective, is the stock market is not the economy. And the stock market can often diverge quite a bit from true economic performance. So as I learned from one of my first mentors, he was adamant about, don't trade your opinion, trade the chart, because you know you might be the outlier, you never know. So that's generally what I do in these webinars. I just try to go off of price and work off of what I have. But you know, that's also one of the reasons that I look for something like we have with this NQYM divergence, where NASDAQ put in that shooting star last week, hasn't yet repressed those highs. The Dow is pressing those highs. So, you know, that could be a possible indication of change on the horizon. Just isn't there yet. But I like the way you're thinking. I like the way you're thinking. Carl, that's awesome, man. Love the feedback. Thank you. And to everybody that's still watching, I really thank you very much for your time. Hour, 10 minutes. We're almost getting to that feature film length there for like an hour and a half. Not quite Oppenheimer, but maybe one day. But thank you so much, everybody, for your time. I really, really appreciate it. I'm going to put that disclaimer back on the screen, so I'd ask you to read it. I'm going to keep it there for another 60 seconds. But thank you again for your time. I'll be back next week, and I hope to see you back in the room. Happy trading, ladies and gentlemen.